How is an X-ray computed tomography measurement made? Today, we're going to find out. My name is Alexander Meaney. I'm a researcher here at the University of Helsinki, and I'm currently working on a PhD in X-ray tomography, also known as computed tomography, or CT. Now, before we continue any further, let's quickly remind ourselves of what we are doing and why. Here we see an X-ray image of a walnut I bought from the local supermarket. It's clear that the X-rays reveal its interior structure in exquisite detail. However, all of the structure is superimposed in the direction of the X-rays. This is called a projection image. In many cases, a simple X-ray projection doesn't provide enough information about the interior structure of the object. This is where computed tomography comes to our aid. Here we see an X-ray tomography slice of the same object. A CT slice is a cross-sectional image formed by obtaining multiple X-ray images taken from different directions and applying a mathematical reconstruction algorithm. The interior structures are no longer superimposed on top of each other, and we have a clear picture of the inside. If you're interested in a more in-depth mathematical description of what X-ray tomography images are and how they're formed, please check out this excellent science video by Professor Samuli Siltanen. The link above will lead you to it. The link is also available in the description below. Let's have a look at what kind of measurement is needed to form a CT image. This is the cone beam X-ray CT scanner of the inverse problems research group at the University of Helsinki. In essence, it's not different from a medical CT scanner in a hospital setting. The only difference is that in the hospital, we rotate the scanner around the patient, but in a small scanner such as this, we rotate the sample inside. The scanner consists of essentially four components: an X-ray source, a sample rotation stage, an X-ray detector, and radiation shielding. This is the X-ray source, also called an X-ray tube. The cone-shaped radiation beam is emitted from the source through a thin beryllium window. So, how are X-rays generated? An X-ray tube is a vacuum tube containing a cathode filament and an anode. The cathode is heated, resulting in thermal emission of electrons. A high voltage is created between the cathode and the anode. The electrons emitted from the cathode experience a force which accelerates them towards the anode. In the resulting collisions with the anode, X-rays are emitted. However, less than 1% of the kinetic energy of the electrons is converted into X-rays, and the rest goes into heating the anode. That's why it's very important to ensure adequate cooling of the X-ray tube so that it doesn't overheat. The X-ray source in this scanner can be used with acceleration voltages ranging from 0 to 50 kilovolts. X-rays are invisible to both the naked eye and to conventional cameras. A special kind of camera, called an X-ray detector, is used to create an X-ray image. How does it work? The X-ray detector contains a scintillator plate. When ionizing radiation, such as X-rays, hits the scintillator plate, it emits visible light. By placing a digital image sensor behind the scintillator plate, we can capture a digital X-ray image, which is then sent to the computer. The sample we are imaging is placed into a rotation stage between the X-ray source and the detector. By rotating the sample and obtaining X-ray projections from all around the object, we can later use the measured X-ray data to compute a tomographic reconstruction. Large X-ray doses are potentially harmful to humans. This is why the entire X-ray scanner has been constructed inside a lead-lined radiation shielding cabinet. So, now that everything is in order, let's start measuring. As is often the case with real data, X-ray measurements are messy and contain all sorts of errors and imperfections. Some of these can be compensated to make sure our data matches the mathematical model as well as possible. One particularly important aspect of X-ray measurements is to calibrate the detector correctly. Here we see the signal from the detector when the X-ray source is off. Let's adjust the grayscale so that the smallest signal value is black and the highest is white. The image is not entirely black, but consists of a set of fixed vertical bands and random electronic noise. This is called a dark current, and it must be taken into account in the calibration of the X-ray data. Because the electronic noise isn't part of the fixed background signal, we'll get rid of it by taking the average of many dark current images. This removes the random noise and leaves the fixed vertical bands. They can be later removed from our X-ray measurements. It's important to ensure that the exposure time setting of the detector matches the measurement settings. Here we see the signal coming from the X-ray detector when the X-ray source is emitting radiation, but there's nothing in between the source and the detector. As you can see, the image is not uniform. The unevenness in the image is caused by variations in X-ray sensitivity in different parts of the detector. Compensating for these differences in the calibration is called flat field correction. Again, we take the calibration image by averaging multiple exposures of the radiation field and subtracting the background from this, resulting in a flat field correction image. Once again, it's important to take the calibration images using the same settings as we will be using in the actual X-ray measurements themselves. The settings to adjust are the detector exposure time, the X-ray tube current, and the acceleration voltage. Here we see the raw X-ray image of the walnut. By applying a post-processing algorithm that utilizes the dark current and flat field calibration images, we can reduce unwanted artifacts in the X-ray data, making it closer to the mathematical model of X-ray imaging. Now we can finally start to measure. We'll be imaging two different samples, the walnut and this pine cone. The X-ray data, already post-processed and corrected for the dark current background and the flat field, will be freely available online. The link is in the description below. In the second part of this tutorial, we'll be looking at how to go from the projection images to actually computing a tomographic reconstruction. Thanks for watching, and see you next time.